So welcome again. Good afternoon. My name is Eva Shevchikova. I serve as the Interim Vice President for University Advancement here at Dominguez Hills. And I want to welcome you to Conversations That Matter, Part 3. For those of you here for the first time, what is Conversations That Matter and how did we get here? Here at Dominguez Hills, we strive to be the model urban university, and part of that charge requires acknowledging when change is necessary, actively listening to our campus community, and maintaining flexibility to evolve our processes and the ways that we engage with one another. During this academic year, we have hosted a number of conversations. Some of them were quite difficult on a number of topics. And as an institution that is grounded in ideas of social justice, equity, and inclusion, we know that difficulty can create reform. We will not shy away from the discourse. We are a learning institution after all, and at all levels, we can learn from each other. And as such, we have created this series called Conversations That Matter. It is also accompanied by the Transparency and Accountability website, a space for us to share information and be transparent about our decisions and our directions. We welcome your thoughts, and we hope you will help us build solutions to make our community healthier, stronger, and more just. Thank you for your voices. Thank you for speaking with us. As always, for today, there was a Zoom link that was sent out to the campus community. We wanted to make sure that those who cannot be here in person also get to participate virtually. And we do have someone monitoring the questions, so later on, when it's time for Q&A, we will check to see what questions were submitted. So a quick recap from our last session. When we last met in December, we covered the work that was being done on the Asian and Pacific Cultural Center, the Toro Food Pantry, both the permanent and satellite locations, and the Aramark contract. Since then, we've done more work in all of these areas. So today I'm happy to share that there will be two parts to the conversation. Part one will be with several of my colleagues, VP Deb Wallace and VP William Franklin. We'll provide updates on their respective areas. And we will then have a few minutes to take your questions and answer them both in person and online. And part two of our conversation today is about getting to action in response to some previous questions that you had about enrollment and retention, some of our student population. So to speak about anti-racism in the academy will be Dr. Bobbie Porter, Dr. Donna Nicol, and Dr. Anthony Samad. They will provide an overview of the findings and recommendations, and then there will be a facilitated discussion that will take about 20 minutes to make sure you can ask more questions and give us more feedback. So with that, with this outline of what's to come in the next 85, 90 minutes, I'm going to invite my colleague, Vice President Deb Wallace, who will share the first update for all of you.
Okay, let me see if I can find. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Just want to thank VP Sekchivika for allowing us this time and the space, and thank you for that introduction. We're going to move through this relatively quickly because I am just excited about the work that Dr. Franklin is going to present, as well as anti-racism in the academy. So we're going to move through this, and as the VP noted, we will be able to entertain hopefully some questions that are coming up online. I wanted to share with the campus the updates. As you all know, I sent to the campus a few weeks ago. We issued a letter of notice of noncompliance and or satisfactory performance to Aramark on February 4th, 2023. As was noted before during our last Conversations That Matter session, you all sent information to us and we heard what you were saying, and we were also having ongoing meetings with Aramark to discuss some of the issues of concern that were coming up. We felt that in accordance with their agreement and the fact that we weren't seeing the improvements in a timely manner, we decided to go ahead and issue this notice of noncompliance and or unsatisfactory performance. The areas that we targeted within that letter were four targeted areas in nature. One was food quality. The other was the lack of a viable marketing and communications plan for our campus community. The other major concern that we had and noted within that letter was around hiring practices. We wanted to make sure that their hiring practices were in accordance with those of the campus. And management of operating expenses. Now, granted, the three above this last one are probably driven by this last one, because management of operating expenditures, they weren't able to make the revenue that they had stated within their agreement. So we wanted to make sure that they were taking care of these three items above in order to realize some of the revenue within the agreement. So that kind of gets us to our current state. We have been having weekly meetings, myself along with Executive Director Tanitra Avery of our newly minted in name, our Toro Auxiliary Partners, and you all may formally know them as the Foundation, have been having weekly meetings with the new leadership team that is here at Aramark. And we have seen some notable improvements. One of the things that we requested, of course, around the food quality is that they were able to hire a brand new chef specifically for our campus. So that individual, we're already seeing some demonstrated changes based on what we're hearing of the voice of the customer. And that is the survey document and survey platform that we use on a regular basis to receive information and survey data from individuals that are getting meals over at our venues. The other thing, the lack of a viable marketing plan and communications plan for the campus. One of the things that we have seen, and we also, based on your notes to us as well, one of the things that you wanted to see is kind of a better cohesive website around the programming and around the information that is available for the campus. And so a lot of the website has been updated. Again, we do know that has been changed. And now with the formulation of the dining committee, one of the things that is happening there is there's a lot of ongoing conversation and communication around some of the issues that are impacting the sales and food quality with Aramark. With respect to the hiring practices, and again, these are just notable changes, just demonstrated changes that we've seen thus far. Around the hiring practices, one of the things that they've been doing, the Aramark team has been doing, is meeting with staff regarding the operations. And I think with respect to the new leadership team that has come aboard, and I'm going to talk about that in just a minute, we have seen a significant change in the hiring practices, and also having conversations with those staff members and students in advance on possible RIF decisions. One of the things that we have been talking about with them specifically is the fact that because the revenues just aren't there, and we think some of this is also the fact that we are right on the heels of of the pandemic, and food industry overall is still there's still some staggering numbers behind food services. So some of that may be driving some of this, but if there's going to be a reduction in force, those individuals that are working in those areas need to know way in advance. And also the scheduling of the individuals needs to be communicated to those employees. With respect to the management operating expenses, I think one of the significant things that has come out of those weekly meetings and meetings to make sure that Aramark is improving not only their service, but again, reducing their operating expenses is their commitment to cap expenditures based on Dominguez Hill's self-op numbers. And what does that mean? Before the pandemic and before we were losing revenue even as a campus, I think the management team that was running the self-op on the campus really did a good job. And what do I mean by that? they were following industry standards as far as what are cost of goods sold to expenses. And Aramark has not been able to fulfill some of that. So the conversations that we've been having with them is that the expectation is that they're going to be able to operate within at least industry standards, and specifically higher education industry standards, for making sure that their cost of goods sold do not exceed their revenue. So we've been having those detailed conversations with them. But they have made a commitment. We are still negotiating this item with them. We received a number from them as of last week, and so we're still negotiating that number with them. The expectation is that wherever Dominguez Hills ended before the pandemic, as far as that number is concerned, the expectation is that Aramark is going to do a really good job in at least meeting that number, or not exceeding that number to a degree that is unreasonable. One of the other, I think, notable things about definite improvements and what Aramark is trying to do, they did present a plan to the cabinet as of 2-6 this month. And one of the things that they did was took the information that we had presented to them and presented this Venn diagram around, again, basically those four items that we talked about around food quality and execution. And you can see some of the things that they have proactively been working on around food waste, for example, around the culinary skill set, around poor inventory being on the campus. All of these things, again, drive that fourth point home, which is if you can't get any of this right, more than likely your revenue and your sales are going to suffer tremendously. One of the other things that they're really working on is that student experience, right? Responsiveness and lack of community connectivity. And we've really been talking to them about making sure that they're working very actively with the dining committee, working really closely with Dr. Smith and his team, the Dean of Students, to make sure that there is that connectivity there, not meeting with students and leadership on campus without that connectivity between the leadership. Right now, if you look under that under the piece under financial performance, you'll see where they are under the current state. Over the last 7 months, we do know that they had a $1.2 million loss. And again, a lot of that loss was driven around what I just presented to you, which was around food waste, them not being able to keep up with the inventory and things like that. But let's just be real. We wanted to make sure that they had the right leadership in those spaces. For example, not having an executive chef on the campus was critical, because we wanted to make sure that the person that was preparing the food was very experienced in making sure that the quality of the food presented to the campus was there. Okay. We also noted, and one of the things that they are definitely working on, is a lack of trust on the campus. They know that they have to regain your trust on the campus, and that also leads to poor participation. Okay. With respect to also the current state, one of the things that we talked to them about was that they had to get leadership on this campus, specifically working with our team, that were fully immersed and engaged in making sure that these were improvements. We were very serious about our notice that we sent to them, and so I think they have shown significant progress. They have a full staff now. I think what is significant on this slide is that Jim Accardi, who is the representative and regional vice president for Aramark for higher education, lives only 20 minutes away from this campus, because that's one of the other things that we ask, is that we need folks on the ground, we need folks engaging with our campus community. And so Jim is here almost on a daily basis. Chanel Brown, we're having conversations with her on a daily basis too. She is the VP of Client Relations. Mr. Dan Burns has also come aboard. These are experienced individuals that have demonstrated success in making sure that these agreements work. He is the regional marketing director. Anna is now the new regional finance director. I said we needed a person who is on the ground, who can talk through these numbers more than once a month. So we were having, according to our agreement, we're at least supposed to be meeting with them once a month, but we're meeting with them on a weekly basis to kind of grind through all of these numbers and make sure that they are fulfilling the things within their contract. One of the other things that happened just last week, they hired an individual that has come in, Michael Burnett. Michael also lives just a few miles away from the campus. He knows the campus, and he is going to be actively engaged on a daily basis as the district manager to try to definitely resolve some of these issues. So what kind of are our next steps as we begin to talk about really the improvements that this campus needs to see in order to maintain this contract? We're still having those ongoing weekly meetings. Those are not going to stop. I will know we have gotten there basically when at some point I don't have to be engaged in all of those meetings, right? When I feel comfortable about where this agreement is going. We're doing ongoing financial reviews. They are also presenting to us on a weekly basis the information that is coming out of those surveys that you all are doing, the student surveys, where you can go online, actually input information into that system. We are receiving those reports on a weekly basis, and that is called the Voice of the Customer Reviews. They have not gotten there with respect to the percentage of where they need to be as far as engagement and things like that. So we're continuing to have that conversation with them. That again goes around the marketing plan and communications plan. How are they really integrated and actively engaging with the campus? I know the question probably is, what if satisfactory progress is not achieved? Again, one of the things we talked about in a previous conversations that mattered is some of the moves that DH can make along that line. Really, this notice that we sent to them on the 4th of February is a first notice, and basically it really takes us into somewhat of a negotiation phase. It allows us to really seek improvements. It allows us to really work as a team and as a partner so we can have demonstrated evidence that they are improving on the things that we have asked. And this is just a reminder again, on that transparency website, all of this information is available. We have put in there that clause that is directly from page 26 and page 27 of that agreement, which talks about our next steps if Aramark has not made significant improvements. Not just improvement, but we need to see significant improvement along that line. I'm going to pause there. I know my time is short. Do any questions along that line? Marco? As you all know, I invited Marco at the last Conversation Matters to my office, so he's been. Thank you for submitting the information.
All right. So for those that don't know me, my name is Marco Alcocet. I am an employee at the DH Express, also the little grab and goes. Right now, I'm off the clock, so therefore, anything that I say, I'm not representing Aramark in any way, shape, or form. However, I do have several questions, which, you know, while I have given you the list, I want to know, basically, where do we stand as employees? Because, you know, obviously, there have been, like, several issues that you've stated on there, and, you know, I agree, there have been some changes in that aspect. However, when it comes to the employee side and the ethics of the workplace, I don't feel like they've made significant changes at all. You know, recently we've had like a whole HR meeting. They've been really trying to get their act together when it comes to like, you know, workplace issues, basic things like training, communication, you know, basic things like scheduling. However, lately it doesn't seem to be changing, and despite the very, you know, the numerous changes they tried to make, it all feels like it's been more in bad faith, because, you know, they've had several months to address such issues, and it wasn't until recently that they decided to then act on it, but even then it's still not enough, like, you know. So for me, what I want to know is that, you know, employees like myself who work there, is there anything that, you know, will be addressed in regards to that side? Because, you know, I like that you guys have addressed like those issues, but I still feel like the employees are still being left out of that conversation. And even then, it, you know, it feels like there isn't enough changes being made on that side.
No, that's a great question and great comments there. And you're right. We have seen some progress, but this is one area where we are definitively saying to them, we have to see progress. One of the things that might have been happening with somewhat, Marco, honestly, with that kind of knee-jerk reaction is that we asked them and we told them we needed them to right-size the revenue and expenditures that were coming in. So unfortunately, that led to mostly a reduction in force, right? But again, that's a knee-jerk reaction. What we want to do is just make sure they're planning with the employees, letting the employees know, here's where we are. We might have to have a reduction in force, and at least give folks an opportunity to maybe right-size their schedules, their school schedules, and things like that. So we are seeing a little bit of progress. That we really do have a new human resources person that was in that leadership team that in that slide that I just showed. So that person is coming on board and working with Jameson and those individuals to make sure that we are communicating that properly with our employees. And again, if folks know what's happening in the business and what changes need to be made in order to right-size that, because we have to get this financial picture to health. If we can't get that right, everything else is moot as far as the agreement is concerned. So, but what I'd like to see Aramark do is really communicate with employees, have sit-down meetings. I know they've started that, but we really felt like that should have been done a little bit earlier in the game. And that was because, again, that leadership just wasn't in place to address some of those issues. But I feel like that's a significant stride that they made in putting those folks in place in order to get us there.
So in response to that, while we have had new people being hired, there still seems to be a lack of action. You know, despite the fact that we now have these new people coming in and these new resources, there still is a lot of lack of trust. Just like the other day, we had an HR meeting that wasn't communicated to us that, like, you know, by the way, this was happening today. So, like, you know, a lot of people, they didn't know until like the last minute. So, you know, they keep focusing on things that aren't part of the issues that we're having. And obviously, when it comes to the financial side of things, you know, I think it's really important that we address the fact that employees haven't been feeling comfortable. They also feel like there hasn't been enough training, things like that. And that's something that I've been really wondering about. It's like, you know, obviously there's like the financial side of it. So like, if we're really expecting a lot of productivity and a lot of finance to be coming back in, I would have expected that the first thing to check out would be like the employee side of things, because if you don't work things with the workforce, how can you expect them to, you know, perform properly and then exceed the expectations of what you want back? So that's probably one of the main things that I feel then play into the whole financial situation, because like on one hand, you know, throughout the years we've been able to, like, you know, show that, by the way, we, you know, we're able to perform greatly, and, you know, we're able to perform in a way that, like, we're able to make money. But unfortunately, ever since the Aramark transition, you know, we've seen people come and go, and, you know, there's been lack of changes. And as far as I'm concerned, a lot of it's not even like being done, like, to a great extent.
Yeah, no, we wholeheartedly agree. And that's why I said, unless we get those things right. And again, this was just our short list. There was some detail around all of those categories, because we feel like if they don't get that piece right, it's going to be really difficult to turn around the numbers. So I wholeheartedly agree with you on that aspect.
Yes. Hi. So
hi.
I'm Claudia.
Hi, Claudia.
I work at CAPE, the Center for Advocacy, Prevention, and Empowerment. So a week and a half ago, I had a really bad, like, food quality experience breakfast at Toro Fresh. And then, so I went on the dining site, and I saw that you can contact Aramark, but it's only Aramark. So I was a little bit unsure, like, does DH get that information?
We do now.
Okay, those emails. And then, so I decided to go on the Auxiliary Partners website, and it's not that easy to get to the survey. I don't know if they're getting that many surveys, because it's kind of hard to find, and so I would think it'd be best to be on the dining website. And I did fill out the survey. They did email me to see, like, if they could talk to me, but I just was unsure that even DH had gotten involved or knew or hears those messages. So I'm like, is it going to get anywhere if I even talk to them? So I didn't. But yeah, I do have like pictures. It was kind of gross. And I threw away like half of it. And it just made me think of our students who are like on a limited income and further not to be satisfied with their food or have to throw it away, or I don't know. It made me sad to think about that, about students. So.
So Claudia, first of all, thank you for your courage and thank you for going on that survey. If you remember last conversations that mattered, one of the things that we were targeting with Aramark is to make sure that we received all information in that voice of customer response, because we were only receiving those that received an exceptionally low mark. So we wanted to change that, and we're now receiving all data. So more than likely, we saw that.
Let me take a question from our online audience. We have about 60 folks on Zoom, so I want to make sure we pay attention to the chat box there as well. So this is a question and a comment, so let me read it in its entirety. As I watch Conversations That Matter from December 7, 2022, I am hearing and recognize that the university's efforts to fulfill and focus on meeting the needs of the students, particularly the basic needs, for instance, food, shelter, psychological needs. However, the students have cultural needs to be addressed as well, which is not being addressed in the conversation. And another major component of why students have a lack of trust and the root of poor participation / support for Aramark. Institutional racist practices and capitalization on mass incarceration affecting brown and black Americans. This conversation needs to address why California State University Dominguez Hills' partnership with Aramark. It is in poor taste regarding the cultural significance and history of CSUDH for black and brown communities and the perpetuation of structural violence and institutional racism by companies like Aramark. Please address this matter and student experiences. Excuse me, and student experiences of anti-black interactions and incidents on campus.
Mm-hmm. Thank you much to whoever sent that question. As you may recall, I believe it was our last one, we only briefly touched on this topic. And I acknowledge, hello everyone, Bobbie Porter, Vice President, Chief Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Officer. I recognize that very point is really what has driven us to even create a Conversations That Matter. And as we were looking at how we best respond to that, we also had to deal with the immediacy of the contract itself. So it's not that we're ignoring this point. We know this is on the minds of many members of our campus community. In a couple of agenda points, we actually will be talking about, to the very last part of that question, speaking to the experience of, I don't know if it was anti-blackness or just racism on campus, but we will talk on that more today. So we aren't ignoring that part. There are just parts that Vice President Wallace will be providing as it relates to the contract, but I agree there is a larger conversation there. As you may recall, I responded to the last time it came up, and I said how we found ourselves in that position was we didn't have a policy or a protocol in place for assessing what would be deemed as the social responsibility of any company that we enter into a contract with. Since then, I have been working with members of our procurement team and others to revise our practice, our protocols, and our policies around how we select vendors. So moving forward, we are taking this into consideration. So please don't see this as us ignoring the topic. We'll be talking more about how we're doing this globally in a few minutes once we get through this update and one that Dr. Franklin will provide. But know that this is on my agenda. It's on the agenda of the cabinet members, and we are taking this into consideration from both an infrastructure standpoint and a response to the immediacy of our contract with Aramark.
Thank you. I'm going to read one more comment question from Zoom, and I want to do a quick time check. We do want to give time to Dr. Franklin to Absolutely. Give his update as well, and then the rest of our agenda for today. So let me read one more. I never went through the hiring process, and they did not follow up with me in regards to the process. I got in trouble for a policy I was unaware of. Lastly, working in the snack shop, the prices are not accurate. They're currently losing employees because of their lack of trust, responsibility, and respect. So this is more in line with some of the earlier comments on hiring. If we don't have any more questions...
One more question.
One more?
Here. Yeah.
Okay, one more quickly, and then we'll move on to Dr. Franklin.
Hi, everyone. Nathan Nguyen, he and pronouns, I'm the program director of the Asian Pacific Cultural Center. Well, I've noticed that lately it's been really difficult to get catering exemptions, and I probably see that because of their revenues are going down, that they're making it harder for most folks to get catering exemptions. And I think it's really important to think about Aramark being the office that approves catering exemption is a conflict of interest, right? Because of course they would not want to approve catering exemptions. And I think it's really important that many of our offices and students, because also my student clubs and orgs who are requesting exemptions are getting a hard time, that they're able to access culturally relevant and authentic food when they do want to cater from off campus as well for some of their programming activities. So I think that's a conversation that really needs to be revisited in terms of who's making these catering exemptions, but also that, you know, I think in a free market, the better caterer will get the contracts, will get the orders. And I think right now, because they're not providing the best service, the market is asking for exemptions, and that still should be respected and approved, even though we see that there is a chicken and egg kind of conversation with revenues.
Yeah, no, good point, Nate. And one of the things that we've been working with them on, too, is not making those decisions in isolation of our team as well. So those are coming to our team as well. We're able to see all of those exemptions now and see the approval. So that part of it is changing as well with respect to catering.
Excellent point. Dr. Franklin?
I can help us make some time back up really quickly. I'm just going to be providing, do I have to move it or you'll move it? Okay, so I'll just be providing some quick updates. The last time we were here, I don't even know if the center was fully open, but now the Asian Pacific Cultural Center is open, Welch Hall 250, you can just go through and I asked Nate to provide, yeah, that's a good place to clap. You can pace through. I asked Nate to provide some visuals of the space and these are some of the latest visuals. You can click again, Katrina. And click one more time. So this is just to give you an opportunity to just sort of see. Seeing is believing, and we've moved. And I want to thank Nate and the leadership team over there, and definitely Deb's team, Chris's team, Mike's team, all the team, the Lakers. No, I'm just kidding. But this was a team effort, and we certainly got it done. But I think you remember those list of demands didn't only just come with space. I'm excited to say that we've been working with the API Student Success Committee. We had a phenomenal couple of meetings, the last one most notably because the committee is full and formed. And this is about access and success. And the more serious we are about that, the more serious we need to be about that. And so this committee is a phenomenal opportunity for us to go deep. Soon you'll be getting word from the committee. We want to sort of broaden this conversation, so it may come back to conversations that matter. It may be a different meeting where we'll pull the campus community together, because seeing is also believing that there are some real actions going into how we recruit, how we retain, how we help matriculate, and then how we graduate, and then try to transform the experiences while they're here. And I think I want to give a shout out to Alana and Matthew in University, University Effectiveness Planning and Analytics. That wasn't effective, but they put together a data set. Data are about conversation, and they gave us a chance to have a clear conversation, a level set conversation around access and success, and we got a lot of work to do. And so excited about the API Student Success Committee. You'll hear more about it. And if you go to the last one, this was a real concern in terms of our food pantries. And so we're excited that the library food pantry is open. Those are the hours, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., Friday, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And you can go in. That's where most of our dry food, our cereals, and our goods are. We also have personal products that are there. And that's the library food pantry. Shout out to the basic needs team, to the CalFresh team for this. And then our I&I food pantry in this building right behind us is open. Any student experiencing insecurity, you can now get fruit, juice, mac and cheese. Some of the more perishable things are there. And again, every sentence is ending. We believe that food is a human right and necessary for your academic success. That's Wednesdays and Fridays, 11 p.m. to 4. I think they mean 11 a.m. Because if y'all hear 11 p.m., there's a whole lot going on. So 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. University Housing, we're excited to announce that on March 13th, our University Housing food pantry will open up. That's a good applause line for that one. I'm so happy about that one. Because just because students are in residence, there's still, you know how it gets late at night and you have to decide whether or not you're going to eat on Monday, Wednesday, Friday? Well, this food pantry will help increase those decisions that yes, food is available, and it's going to be in our phase 3C store, which used to be our convenience store that we've now moved and turned it into a food pantry. And so we'll have more announcements by the next conversation that matters, as well as on the accountability and web accountability and transparency website. And lastly, coming soon, Teddy's Pantry, which is going to be the library I&I and the UH pantries exist due to a temporary delay in getting that pantry open. But that's just not a pantry, that's a basic needs hub. You'll be able to sign up for CalFresh there, connect with social workers, look at some of the community resources that are going on in our communities, because we can't do this alone. We're in the community, we got to be of the community. But also there'll be a pantry there where there'll be dry produce, and there'll be fresh meats, not dry produce. We don't want dry produce. We want fresh produce, dairy meats and dry staple goods for students. And that estimated construction is going to, remember, that's what kind of shocked this group. And we thought, wait, Teddy's Pantry's not going to open up until August. And then because of the community outcry, we began moving those things around the circle and making this thing happen. So these conversations do matter. They're going to continue to matter. And we're going to continue to keep them alive. Mm-hmm. I don't know if there are any questions, but I'll stop there. And hopefully we're back on track and we can get to what I think is going to be a real important conversation. I'm looking forward to hearing. There we go. I guess I got to bring the mic. This is full service.
So talking about space, hello everybody, my name is Ana Miriam, I use she, her pronouns, program director of the Toro Dreamer Success Center. And so because we're talking about space right now, I know that part of the university strategic plan talks about having functional inadequate space for like culture and identity centers. Is there any conversations about space, especially because I know that most cultural centers will have a coordinator starting fall 2023? And where are their offices? And also QCRC, they still have like a very small space. So if we can address that.
Yeah, I'm excited to announce, and VP Wallace might want to say more about it. We have a space and utilization committee, because you were right. Some space that's being utilized now is underutilized, and it was utilized like that when the Jackson Five were together, and we're still using it like that. And so we need to relook at that. There's also some spaces that are being used for storage. Well, we could probably convert those spaces. So there's a larger conversation going on. The Black Resource Center and QCRC are top of the list in my mind in terms of space pieces, especially QCRC. You can't go by QCRC and go in and it's not crowded. And that matters because the space is so small. And so there's a lot of conversations going to happen around space. I'm hoping that one of our conversations that matter will get to meet the University Space Committee, understand what their priorities are, what they're looking into, and then begin to, of course, hold them accountable for making some immediate space decisions. And then there are some that are going to be a little bit longer term. But we have not been using space wisely, intelligently, judiciously, or what I would call collaboratively. And it's time to mature and get into that space, and I think that's where we are. Yes. Oh, go for it. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lily Arana, and I am the CAPE advocate and counselor for the Center for Advocacy, Prevention, and Empowerment. I know we were talking about space, so one of the things I remember from one of the previous conversations that matter was that there would be a request form for space. Currently, we're located in the Student Health Center, and there's limited visibility for students to find us. Like, we need to give them a map and a doorbell to ring to even get to us. And talking about retention of students, you know, this is something that they need to be able to access us, especially when they're in a crisis or if they really do need that support right then and there, either from myself or from someone else in our office. So one of my questions is there going to be a website or a form where we can submit and hopefully the space committee can prioritize certain places, like obviously the QCRC, but also our space is very important for those students, staff and faculty who are undergoing, you know, sexual assault, domestic violence, harassment, whether it's on campus or off campus, and it's hindering their ability to be academically successful, but also performing well in their employment on campus as well.
Such a great question. And I know that the University Space Committee will be having a retreat soon. So they're gonna get away and get their acts together. And that was ACT for those of you who are online, because it almost came out the other way. So it is important because we are not utilizing space well. And you bring up a key point that this is a program where you're tucked away and that does not serve. And there are a lot of programs that are like that, that are tucked away. And there are a lot of programs that are really visible who would probably enjoy being tucked away because they don't need that kind of visibility. That's where we've got to get more connected and more collaborative and have those deep and hard conversations. I think they're standing here waiting for me to get off. But thank you so much for that, because that is the key point in terms of where we need to go and where we're on our way to. Eva.
We'll take one last question over here, and we are not showing any more questions online. So I want to give an opportunity for...
I didn't want to take up anyone else's question time. I'm really good at putting my foot in my mouth. I hope I don't do it too bad right now. But I love my professors. I love my educators. And it has been out of everything that I'm learning, I'm sorry, my name is Kevin Jones. I'm a senior graduating this spring. And it has been an inspiration to receive what I received in these 2 years from my professors. And what troubles me the most, and I know that you all are probably talking about it, working on it, it's probably not new, but it troubles me that my professors are crammed into such tiny spaces. The children are only as good as the parents. And so if the educators have it tough, the students are gonna have it tough. I wonder if the campus leadership is considering giving much more ample space to educators on campus. Like my mentor, Dr. Nicol, other professors I've had, they do a lot for us. I don't care if you're a young student or an older student, they do a lot for us. And These are just my thoughts. I've done no research on it, haven't investigated anything. I'm just concerned for the welfare of the educators, the ones that you all hire on and bring on to raise up the next who are coming. If we're not taking care of the educators, you can't take care of the students.
You said it all. I mean, I don't have to make any more comments other than yes and amen. And I'm hopeful that we will begin to mature into the campus that we say we are and walk the talk and do right by not only faculty, staff, and students, but also the community that we serve, because we're in this community. And so space, it can't be our final frontier. It's got to be our first line of understanding that equity is about making sure there's equity.
One last quick question from Obi, and then we'll move on to the next piece.
Hi, everyone. My name is Obi Halbuna. I'm the ASI president. I love giving praise to where praise is due, and the Senate Affairs has done a beautiful job in at least answering some of our requests. But I don't like sounding like a broken drum, but I've always said this: information is a basic need. This is beautiful, but if nobody knows about this, it's it's as good as we not getting it because nobody knows about it. What has been done to bridge the information gap here on campus? When we talk about space, even to add this about space, we have a huge front wall in LSU that could be used to advertise stuff. It's just a blank wall that could be used to advertise stuff. I'm just wondering, I was looking at that wall, I'm like, something needs to be there. And I'm so surprised here on campus that no one has thought about it. Or I thought I did until I spoke before. And I see that ASI 5 years ago had made the same request. We need something that tells everyone what's going on campus, something so visible. But yet, I thought it was a new idea for me, and I found out that my predecessors were way ahead in time. What is the campus doing to bridge the information gap here on campus? Thank you very much.
Won't have time to go. Myla Edmond, who's not here today, we also don't communicate very well. There are multiple channels, from our social media channel to our website to any pamphlets and any leaflets. I see Dr. Herbert is here. We now have QR codes. We'll be in every classroom around where our resources are. So this is where we partner with you, OB. We partner with ASI. We partner with the Faculty Senate. We partner with staff. And we try to have multiple channels of getting it out. It is one thing to have those, but you're right, if folks don't know it, so Myla will be here. Maybe we can talk about a communication strategy writ large and university-wide in order to address this. So I know I felt like heat behind me because I think they're ready for me to go. So let me go. So thank you all. Looking forward to more, and I look forward to getting into this conversation with Dr. Nicol and Dr. Samah.
Yes. That heat was not intentional. But conversation well had. Thank you for your questions. Thank you for engaging us because it signals to us that we still have work to do. We still have conversations among ourselves. Please know that for everything we talk about in these events, we take it back as a senior leadership team and determine how can we take action on it. So I appreciate that. And we always have a plan coming into these, knowing that we may have to edit ourselves in the moment. So we are behind schedule. So I'm going to make a bit of an adjustment because I've invited Dr. Nicol and Dr. Samad, and you can come on to the front, to speak with you about a very important effort that was happening well before I came to Dominguez Hills. And what I planned initially was to provide this beautiful opening and context for the work that they did, give them about 20, 25 minutes to talk about what this task force was initially charged to do, what they found in their efforts, and what they recommend moving forward. But we are a little short on time, so what I'm going to, and then from there, we were going to engage in a broader discussion with everyone present, as well as those online, just to unpack what we heard them say. And then from there, y'all, was really ambitious. I was going to share what I was going to do as the inaugural Chief Diversity Officer in response to these findings and recommendations. So I find it very important that we leave plenty of room to have conversations that matter, particularly when they're related to social justice in any way. So rather than on the tail end of that and me coming back up and doing a lot of talking or engaging with the with those in the room, we'll get as far as we can, and then we'll find another way to get the information out. But what is important to me is that in the time we have left, in the next 20, 25 minutes, I really want to give the microphone over to Drs. Nicol and Samad so they can lay out the work that the task force has done, what they recommend, what they found and what they recommend, and then I'll come back at a later point, maybe in other conversations that matter, maybe a lunch and learn, maybe a blog, I don't know, and share what we'll be doing at an institutional level. So with that, I welcome Dr. Donna Nicol, who is the chair of the Department of Africana Studies, as well as Dr. Anthony Samad, who is the executive director of the Dymally Institute. These individuals are not strangers to you. Just one point, since we have to change our agenda just a little bit. Are there any other members of the task force, the anti-racism in the Academy task force, who are in the room? Thank you. If you're willing and able, could you stand so we could formally recognize you as Drs. Nicol and Samad prepared to do this work? Please know that on behalf of President Parham, we are grateful for your service to the institution. And with that, I'll hand the microphone over.
Thank you, Dr. Porter. Good afternoon, family. So, Dr. Nicol and I were charged with one of the most difficult tasks that one as an academic could endure. What we thought was going to be a six-month assignment ended up being a two-year assignment. It was supposed to be until, at the time, the Chief Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Officer position was vacant. So we were trying to address the President's concern of immediacy. And this came about as a result of a seminal moment in American history. Now, when we talk about seminal moments as it relates to civil rights, we have Emmett Till, we have Rodney King, and then we have an event called George Floyd. In each of those instances, we saw a shift in the social culture of the United States. That was followed by protests, some disruption, and the need to address something immediately, and that is the legacy of American racism. So right after the George Floyd event, Dr. Nicol set the campus on fire. She put out a list of demands. And the president's position was, well, I usually don't acquiesce to demands, but there's nothing here on this list I disagree with. And we were having some cultural issues of our own. We live in a society that is highly diverse, and everybody has their issues. And certainly while we didn't want to get into protracted debates about comparative misery, because everybody's been oppressed, everybody's been discriminated against, but it seems like the moments that change American culture happen to African Americans. And anti-blackness in the United States has been here since 1619. And so we had had some incidents on our campus right after the appointment of our new president. And then we began to see faculty leave, black faculty. We began to see black staff leave. And as recently disclosed in our, you know, Black Student Success Working Group, we are even seeing black students leave. Environment is important. We just had a conversation that preceded this about the importance of environment. Environment is important to everybody. Work environment, school environment, social environment, family environment. Those are all interconnected. And so the president invited Dr. Nicol and I into his office and asked us to address some issues. He says, we got to get to the bottom of this fast. And so he appointed an anti-racism task force, and he asked for our recommendations as to who we wanted on the task force. And we wanted the task force as diverse, not only racially diverse, gender diversity, position diversity. And so we had someone on the task force from every aspect of the community. And these are the members of the task force. And we represented to them, as was represented to us, that this was a short-term assignment. And it wasn't a short-term assignment. And this was a hostile proposition, because the one thing that people don't want to talk about is racism. And we had some massive resistance on this campus in talking about racism. And so we tried to create an environment that would be open, people could express candor, but both Dr. Nicol and I said that we did not want to participate in any kind of feel-good engagement, if that we weren't going to attack the issue head-on, then we would rather not do this. And the president gave us his blessing to go for it. So we busted out. Is this the one? So the first thing we did as a task force is we met four times to talk about how we focus this issue. How do you take on an issue that is a factor in the larger society, and the campus is a reflection of the larger society, and people have their inherent biases, people have their aggressions and microaggressions that make it difficult to work collegially in an environment which we have impressionable minds. We're supposed to be teaching them about the world. The university is supposed to be the last bastion of free ideas, free discussion. And we had faculty, staff, and administrators that did not want to talk about racism. And they did not want to talk about anti-black racism. So, well, why do we have to talk about this? Because it exists. And so we gave folk an opportunity to write statements. The president put out an edict that every department and every college was supposed to write an anti-racism statement. And you would have thought that he had asked you to write War and Peace. Some people posted their statements. Some people didn't. Some people said they were still talking about it. 2 years later, they're still talking about it, still haven't produced a statement, okay? And so we decided to, of course, do a survey. Now, both Dr. Nicol and myself are averse to surveys because black people are the most studied people in the history of the world. Yet the problems persist. But we wanted to find out, we wanted to do a self-assessment as to how we thought of ourselves as a university. Did we think we were an anti-racist campus? Did we think that we were a campus that had some racial problems? Did we think that everything was okay with the world and that was just another isolated incident? Okay, and so we gathered and analyzed various department statements on Black Lives Matter. We held forums and asked people to say Black Lives Matter. It was even difficult for folk to say Black Lives Matter. You know, we had to get into this senseless debate about All Lives Matter. But All Lives wasn't being choked out on live television, okay? And so we wanted to really understand how people saw Dominguez Hills as a work environment, as an academic environment, as a social environment. And so we gathered data, we pulled together the Campus Climate Survey in 2019, and then we reviewed the anti racist organizational measurement tools that we developed and selected one to serve as the campus climate survey. And then we developed and secured IRB approval to administer the survey tool to the campus. Now, we also participated in several campus-wide forums. At the time, Dr. Laura was the Academic Senate president, and she held several It Takes a Village programs as a way to assess and gather anecdotal data about the campus climate. Some people were very active in their participation, but some people weren't. There was a silence. We requested information about departmental and college-based reading and discussion groups on race and racism. Again, that was a struggle. We created a tentative priority list and timeline for recommendations for President Parham, which was supposed to be December of 2019. Is that correct? 2020, okay, thank you. We're in 2023, okay? And then the Dymally Institute took on the task as a think tank who is, I would say, provocative in terms of our programming, in terms of initiating public discussion. So we had three anti-racism workshops, and we decided to use tools that were historical vestiges of racism. Now, when I tell you white people lost their mind over this one, they did. Why we gotta use white people? Well, racism is just not a black problem or a brown problem or an Asian problem or a Native American problem. It's a white people's problem. Okay? And somehow we always find ourselves talking to the choir. So after all the pushback on this, and there was a lot, anonymous emails, we were trying to find out what were they offended about, white or only? Because this sign comes directly from the segregation era of the United States. It was posted in 33 of the 50 states on some level or another, including California.
Excuse me, Dr. Samad. I just wanted to do a time check. We have about 10 minutes left.
Okay. Yes. All right, I'll speed it up.
Okay.
So we had one to talk about anti-racism for racial reconciliation. The second one was called For Colored Only, and it talked about othering. And that was at a time where there was a rise in anti-Asian racism, largely due to the spread of COVID, which are previous president of the United States, whose name shall not be mentioned, at least not from me, termed a global pandemic, termed it the China flu. And as a result, so-called patriots, which were nationalists, decide to vent their hatred toward Asian folk all over the country, okay? And then the third one was talking about no dogs, no Negroes, no Mexicans. And it specifically targeted devaluation, how historically people of color have been devaluated in our society. And we had very, very great discussions, and the community was invited. For this one, 1,200 registered over the course of, and all of them were virtual because we were in the midst of contagion. And 700 people showed up for this one. And for the second one, it was about 400, and for the third one, it was about 300. But the point was to get people talking about a difficult topic that basically impacts everybody in American society. And so, without further ado, I would like to introduce our co-chair, who basically will give you the data as we found it, and the next steps of the task force. The task force has been handed over to Dr. Porter. They say our work is complete, but our work's not complete. The Dymally Institute has continued to have anti-racism as a discussion, as demonstrated by our last distinguished speaker, Dr. Robin DiAngelo, who wrote the books Nice Racism and wrote the books White Fragility. Dr. Nicol.
Does this microphone work?
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a quick rundown of our survey data and talk a little bit about some of the components that made up how we came to give President's Cabinet a set of recommendations. It is an incomplete preliminary report that we ended up having because we were unable to get the focus groups done that would be necessary to give a more robust report. But here we go. So we initiated the anti-racism survey. It was really essentially one question. Where do you see Dominguez Hills on a continuum from racist to anti-racist? And so we invited members of the campus community. And so we divide campus community in the report in two ways, students and then institutional agents. That would be faculty, staff, and administrators. We had participation of 1,114 people. 80% of that were students. We had 11% faculty participation, 7% staff, and 1.5% administration. Out of that number, when it comes to the findings suggested that since there was such a small participation of institutional agents, that we actually need to administer the survey again. Actually, it's unconscionable and quite appalling for a campus that calls itself social justice minded to have so little participation for the people who are supposed to help foster a community of social justice activism. But here, the findings basically said that the students saw Dominguez as fully inclusive and an anti-racist institution. But when we started to unpack some of the demographic data that also went along with this, we were concerned that a lot of students don't know the difference between non-racist and anti-racist. So that is some education around racial literacy that still needs to take place. We had such a small participation of faculty and staff and administrators that in order to teach that racial literacy to our students, we would need to make sure first we have buy-in from the institutional agents. And we can't say that we have that. And part of this might have to do with the fact that Dominguez has, there is a history, I call it a mythology, about our social justice roots, because I've studied the history of this campus in more detail, but we tell this story and in a lot of ways kind of deflect from dealing with actual conversations, hard conversations about race. If you want to have a conversation with me on the side about this history, I can tell you, but that's for another day. What this all suggests in terms of our survey is that Dominguez actually kind of lands right in the middle between racist and anti-racist. And we have a lot of work to do in order to get to anti-racism, starting with developing a common racial literacy for everyone. Some of the other activities that we did was an analysis. There we go. Okay, we did an analysis of these statements that various departments created, and we had participation across student affairs, academic affairs. And so our charge for this subgroup was to analyze these departmental statements after the murder of George Floyd, and then to assess how the departments were starting, were stating their core beliefs and values around anti-black racism, identify strategies that departments were willing to undertake to lessen or end anti-racism on our campus, and then to use these statements in conjunction with our quantitative survey to present a more comprehensive view of the campus. This was the rating model that we used, and it comes from Teaching for Social Action. So there's levels of social action, starting from the contribution, where you just focus on the heroes and the holidays and so forth, all the way to social action, where you take much more divisive steps to ameliorate social issues and problems. So we had 31 participants or divisions that wrote statements that we were able to collect. There may have been more, but we didn't get, I specifically sent messages to deans, and this is the participation that we got. By far, the College of Arts and Humanities had the most robust participation, probably because we are the college where conversations about race take place. But we had some really great statements as well from the College of Health, Human Services, and Nursing. We had a little bit of participation from the College of Natural and Behavioral Sciences. We had one statement from the College of Business, none from the College of Education, but that asterisk is there for a reason, none from Extended Education, one from the Library, six from Student Affairs, and then Academic Affairs Other. So if you want more detail, I can give you that later. These are how we collectively looked at the statements and we gave them rating numbers. And so these are the averages. Some were higher or lower. So for example, I want to shout out the history department on our campus because they have developed, they said they were going to develop programming to address race with their Race, Power, and History series, and they've kept to that. If you look at occupational therapy, they by far blew everybody out of the water with their statement. Their statement was super detailed about their core values, how they were going to change the curriculum, how they were going to work on hiring, everything. And then CBAP had one, only one submitted, but it was a really good statement. And this was from public administration, if I'm not mistaken. And so this gives you a range of how we fared. And so here were some of the general conclusions. A lot of the statements were very performative. We stand in solidarity because we believe racism is wrong, and that was it. We concluded that a lot of these statements were not a priority for some departments. But the lack of participation in developing statements, along with the lack of participation in the survey, signals to us a concern, at least among the faculty, that we might have some trouble dealing with racism on campus if people can't even commit to having a conversation in their department. We know of at least one instance where creating this statement created turmoil in the department. We had another instance where someone contacted me and said, well, we're waiting to hire a person of color to come take the lead on this work. And then finally, we had requests for people to participate after the fact. Well, these were supposed to be in the moment kind of documents. And so asking for more time after a year, because we waited for a year before we asked for these statements, just kind of signaled to us this was still not a priority. The reason why those statements were so important for our committee is because they were they were statements that people needed to make or wanted to make to let us know that they cared about this issue. And so we combined that, like I said, to kind of get a more comprehensive view. What we did, because we did not have focus groups, we took the list of demands that Africana Studies made, changed them into priorities to soften the language. But what we did do is go through and made a list of priorities, talked about all of the resources that were necessary to carry forth those priorities, and when we expected cabinet to start to take action on those particular priorities. So for example, the top priority was to work on the recruitment of black students, recruitment and retention. And we combined recruitment and retention into one because oftentimes universities recruit without their eye focused on retention. And so they get students here, but they don't have a plan to get them through. So those are some of the things that we did with the task force. Another thing that was a challenge for Dr. Samad and I is that we were also working on our community engagement work. And so we just completed working on the State of Black Los Angeles County report. And so we had a lot of moving parts going on while we were working on this. My hope is that now that we do have an Office of Diversity, Equity, Inclusion, that there could be significant more follow-up on the findings. We're still very committed to this work because we think it's important, particularly because the university and tends to, and this is CSU-wide, but specific to Dominguez also, we talk about underrepresented minority students, but we don't tease out the fact that black students on this campus don't graduate. They have a lower graduation rate between 6 and 12% over a six-year period. And so collapsing everybody together without attending to the specific cultural, social needs really obscures what is happening on the ground with our students. Thank you.
No, thank you. I wish we had another hour. There was so much. So connecting back to what I said earlier, this warrants a separate event, and I hope that you two will join me so we can continue this conversation as well as members of our campus community, because there is a lot of work that you all did. You set me up well as an inaugural chief diversity officer, so I don't have to come in and start from scratch. You essentially gave me a head start. So just very briefly in our last few minutes and as we conclude, coming in, I believe even during my interview, President Parham charged me with taking the ball and keep running with it when it comes to both the anti-racism and the Academy Task Force and the Gender Equity Task Force. And I've been meeting with the leaders of both of these task forces since coming on, and we are at the point where we're determining just how we begin to implement the recommendations. But I have so many more questions around the findings themselves, so I hope that you all will be in community with us as we continue to unpack the work of both of these task forces. There's just not enough time, but Dr. Nicol, we had a question that came from the online audience that if you could sum it up in a few words, can you describe the difference between non-racist and anti-racist?
Good question.
So in a nutshell, a non-racist is someone who does not go out and actively commit a racist act or hold or say something racist or do something in a racist way. An anti-racist is someone who stops or prevents racism from taking place. So there is a level of passivity with being a non-racist versus being more active and engaged and taking risk as an anti-racist.
Thank you. Thank you so much. again, much more to come on that, but I don't want to leave you just thinking I'm sitting with this information and doing nothing with it. So just three quick points based on the findings and recommendations from the task force. Racial literacy is a huge one, and what we're doing to provide professional development. You all may have seen a message that I sent out on Friday regarding our participation in a racial equity leadership alliance. This is a professional development tool where we can begin to interrogate and increase our collective capacity for engaging in racial equity work. We'll have our first convening this Friday. It's going to be led by Sean Harper. We hope you will join us. You do have the link in your email, so please, please sign up and see us there, but much more to come there. That is a three-year engagement, so we have at least 3 years that the institution has committed to providing specific professional development on this topic. We are also engaging in the effort to create a framework around identity-based support services for our campus. Right now, it's disparate, and it depends on who has the loudest voice in this moment. So we are engaging campus stakeholders, those who are interested, units who do this work on a daily basis, to establish a framework so we're no longer doing the one-offs and sort of approaching it with the diversity flavor of the month, but instead using intentionality in these efforts. And then lastly, what is really clear to me is that in going far together, we allude and speak directly to many elements of social justice, but there is no definitional aspect of that. We're making an assumption that people, that when I read social justice and when Dr. Franklin reads social justice, we have the same conversation. If we are moving beyond just the umbrella underrepresented minority work, we have to be intentional. We have to be specific in our language. So over the next year, we will be engaging in the work to really define and call out what we mean by all of those social justice related terms in going far together. So we then have an infrastructure that we can build policy and practice. I'm also a part of several efforts where we are doing just what you mentioned, Dr. Nicol, just not doing a blanket high level understanding of, oh, we need to help students or people of color, but instead we have at least two work groups right now focused on Black student success and API student success. So far, far more to come from that. But if you can just join me in a round of applause just one last time for Drs. Nicol and Samad and the Racial Equity Task Force.
Thank you, Dr. Porter, thank you, Dr. Nicol, and thank you, Dr. Samad. I'm going to provide a quick summary of what we think we've heard you say to us today, because at the end of the day, this is what this event was about, to hear your voices. So we've heard you say, starting from the very beginning of today's conversation, that Aramark, in your point of view, has not made significant changes in the climate for their employees, and you still feel left out of the conversations. You've also pointed out to us that our students have cultural needs and that there is a need for the rubric of social responsibility as part of our vendor selection. You've pointed out the conflicts of interest that you've noticed when it comes to approving catering exemptions from Aramark. We also need to have more conversations about spaces on this campus, specifically spaces for our cultural centers. We need prioritization, a request form for space. You feel and you're concerned that our faculty are crammed into really tight spaces, and you recognize and acknowledge, and mostly you want to highlight to us how tough it is for our educators to work in these spaces. OB has reminded us very wisely that information also is a basic need. It is very important to have visibility of information on our campus and bridge the gaps that we're seeing. We need to do more to ensure access and success for all students, and we certainly need to continue our conversations about what we just heard from this task force. We've heard you say, and this is a most recent online comment, that this was a little difficult to follow, and there was just a lot to unpack in this analysis. So it sounds like we need to come back to this so that we're not so rushed in our conversations. Are there any other topics that you just want to shout out that we should think about for our next conversations that matter? I'm going to give you a little bit of time to think through. If you don't have a topic right now, that's okay.
On the website, on the transparency and accessibility website, there's going to be an email address posted tomorrow. So we encourage you to, if you have additional topics that we haven't touched on today, please submit it. And as always, the conversation today was recorded. It will be available on the website. The link will be shared with the campus community. Let me remind you of the URL. If you go to csudh.edu/transparency-accountability. So this is sort of the repository of all updates, of all information. Every single webpage on our website is linked to this transparency website. So you will find it no matter where on the website you are. Please check your emails for the next date for our next Conversations That Matter. That'll be our number 4 together. Please attend, whether it's in person or whether it's online. We want you to be part of the discussion. We will continue listening so that everybody's voice is heard. This is an ongoing conversation. Thank you for attending. Thank you for all your thoughtful questions. Don't forget to submit more topics that you're interested in. And I wish you, on behalf of all of us here today, a wonderful day. Stay dry.